Afternoon, guys. Thank you for joining this short webinar. Let me get started. So as Vinay introduced me, I go across customers and talk about how the data centers, the new data centers, and the security and the cloud infrastructure should be planned, and help them discuss out the solution. So most of the time, as soon as I introduce myself as an IT expert, data center expert, one important question comes into the mind from the customer is, what do you think about SDN? What is it that it can do for you? So before I start the presentation, I just wanted to use two slides to set the context here. The first slide is about what is this SDN thing, because the whole thing started about 5 years back as part of the university project. That time the SDN was thought of to be like some kind of centralized controller for the network, that is, instead of having multiple switches and routers, having an operating system running in them. The idea was that we could put a centralized operating system which will control all these boxes. But as soon as people figured out, that time the popular protocols were OpenFlow, and people slowly figured out that this whole approach actually is not solving any new problem. All these problems already solved. So as the time progressed, people have redefined SDN to mean something much more meaningful. That is, SDN as a compiler. That is, if anyone of us has any programming background, we all understand that in our colleges we used to do all the chips, we used to do assembly level programming. Even for adding two numbers, there was lots of instructions that need to pass. We need to allocate a memory, initiate the integers, add the integers, and do lots of stuff. With the advent of higher level programming like C, C++, you don't need to worry about the low-level instruction. In a couple of lines, you can just add the numbers. And as things progressed, people started building on top of it. Now, very specialist programmers program in C, C++. People have started programming in a much higher-level program. So in the same context, where C, C++ is a compiler, you just give a high-level instruction, the low-level integrity of how the registers are allocated, how the gates are used to add the number, that is not to be worried about. That will be taken care of by the low-level programming. Exactly the same thing is emerging in the SDN world. So SDN has become a compiler where you give a high-level instruction saying, I just want this network, this virtual machine to be created, or this new network to be created, and all the relevant configuration details, nitty-gritties are taken care of by the software layer beneath it. That is the one context I want to keep in mind, saying SDN is more of an intent-based networking. That's how it's going evolving towards, and we will try to understand what is the implications for security on out of the SDN. The other context, this is a necessary slide in all security presentation, where there are three main trends that we are seeing. One is the attack is becoming more and more sophisticated. Vinay touched upon this just in the introduction. I will leave that aside. We are all agreeing to the fact that threats are getting sophisticated. And doing advanced analytics on them on a firewall or some software on site is becoming difficult. So that's why most of the OEMs are trying to make the complex computation and analytics on the cloud so that they can do a much faster analysis and real-time understanding of the threat. The second one, which is the cloud, this has been happening for some time. Now people are no longer on the boundary fence. Most of the people have already crossed. So there are various flavors of cloud implementations that are happening from the application side. And obviously that brings with it most, if you see the survey, the one of the main concerns with the cloud is security, how to control it, how to take care of it. The third trend is the number of devices in the infrastructure. The infrastructure itself is growing fast. BYOD was a big thing. Now IoT is a big thing. Once upon a time the only IoT devices in our campus used to be access control devices and IP telephony. Now the number of devices are expected to grow much faster. So with these two things in context, which is the SDN as a high level intent engine, and second the complexity of the security, let me start the real punch of the presentation. As we all know, from the security perspective, there is no such thing like 95% secure or 99% secure. You cannot have a bit of security left out, because your hackers have millions of times to attempt, and they have to succeed only once. So as a security professional, as a security engineer, it's almost impossible to assume that I will be able to secure a network. And that's the reason the traditional way of security in the IT world is you define your own parameter. That is, you say these are my trusted assets, data center, these are the few servers, and beyond, and outside that you create a parameter and guard the parameter and try to do it. This is like the airport model of security. Everyone who goes in the airport, if you are a passenger, you need to have a boarding pass and an ID card. If you are an employee, then you need to have an employee card which is issued by the particular airport and stuff like that. Wherein before you are allowed in, there has to be trust. But once you go inside, you have relative good degree of freedom in the area. But obviously, this has got a couple of problems. We need to move from the airport model to more like a hotel model. In hotel, when you want to go inside the hotel, there is a minimal check done. Somebody checks your car and you're allowed to go in. And then you have almost a free access to the guest area. But people are watching you, but nobody will stop you from accessing the guest area. And then if you want to go in the rooms, then there is a second level of card access required to reach the floor. And from the floor, you need to have access to the room. So basically, we need to go from just creating a single parameter and trying to guard it, because that's increasingly has proved to be not good enough. We need to basically assume that there are going to be lots of lateral movement, and it's very much possible that things are compromised, and you need to design your security based on that. I will cover these into big details. The other big problem that we see is we have lots of security devices. There is a gateway protection solution, which is normally a firewall out there. There is an IPS engine. There is an antivirus, which is doing a patch management update. All these sensors are giving you signals, and there is a threat level that comes from each of these, and it gets collated in SIEM. But it is the job of the SOC operator to figure out how to correlate it, because every signal might be different. Let's say a particular threat comes from a guest user versus the same kind of threat alert comes from a finance user. The implications might be very different. So it gets very difficult, because there are too many alerts, that threat scores that you're getting, and they are pretty much uncoordinated. The only way we had as of today is we need to have an SIEM, and manually you figure out how to do what to do stuff over there. And the most important part from the operations perspective day to day is the business policies. The security policies might be disconnected from the business. The business says, let's say you get a request saying a particular finance users can access a particular set of servers and nothing else, or maybe they give an instruction that all the video watching on the internet is restricted after 5 o'clock. That is a business decision that comes to, let's say, an IT manager or CIO. The CIO passes into the IT guy, when he goes to the engineer who actually configures the policy, he needs to map all these instructions into what are the apps, what is the host IP, what are the zones, VLAN, subnet, and basically it gets translated into a couple of 5-tuple commands that you put in the firewall. Once you start doing this translation, after a couple of years, when you look in the firewall, there are hundreds and thousands of rules, and there is no way to figure out why these rules were there, and they're pretty rigid. Let's say if the finance department adds one more server, then somebody has to figure out that translates into what rule and add those rules again. If somebody removes the server, people will forget to move out those things. So there is a big disconnect. Normally, there is a manual intervention required from the business outcome perspective to the actual policy configuration. These are the three things that we would focus on in the next slides. Based on these three problem statements, Juniper Security Vision is pretty straightforward. you don't build a network and try to secure it. Try to build a network which is secure from day one. Sounds very English. We will figure it out as we go along. The idea is more towards simplification and automation. Let's start with the first problem that we talked about, perimeter-oriented security. In the data center, people are beginning to talk about this with the availability of SDN solution. The idea being, every VM should be in its own zone, and whenever a VM wants to talk to any other VM, there has to be explicit allow. The important thing is now the parameter, instead of being the whole data center or a DMZ, it is for each VM separately. So you are making a micro segmentation or micro parameterization. An important thing is when the traffic moves across this perimeter boundary, which is now much smaller, you have a visibility into that. Ideally, if you have a DMZ where are 20 servers, the lateral movement in within the servers which are there in the DMZ, there is almost like no visibility. With this concept saying we need to create a micro parameterization, you can actually have begin to have a visibility between the VMs. The second part about the feeds, so there needs to be a mechanism. I think people are beginning to work across the industry to address this. What now most of the security devices, they have a way to take lots of feeds from third party, or let's say the feed coming from command and control, let's say IDS network or antivirus server. All these guys are creating a feed which is collated in a cloud-based environment so that it normalizes the feeds, and it gives you a very action intent saying threat level is overall 3, and then you have to take an action, which is much more simpler in the original way where the threat levels are coming from different devices. One is saying 5, one is saying 3, one is saying 4, and based on all these threats you need to take a final decision. That's the reason most of the time all the logs sit on top of the SIM, because there is no simplified actionable item. So people are beginning to create this threat digestion engine, which is normalizing the threats and giving a very simplified intent-based threat levels, which can be enforced in real time. I will talk about this real time as we go soon further. The third important part is the how to create a natural language-based policy configuration. On the right side, if you see, there is an example one saying, quarantine users in the HR department in Sunnyvale. Sunnyvale is a location in US, when infected with malware code. Its instruction is very simple. If you see a user, or if there is alert that a user is infected with malware and the threat level is more than 4, then do something about it. If you want to have this natural language translation, you have to do some homework. There are 4 or 5 things that you need to create. One is you need to pre-configure the actions. Normally the actions are allow, block, quarantine, and secondary actions are email or basically a log or something. That has to be done manually. Then you can create a groups. Some of these groups we are doing already. We know that in the AD Active Directory and RADIUS, we already create a group, HR users, marketing users, and probably the location-based groups can be created based on AD. There is now a need to create an application-based group. If you're already using a vCenter and all your applications are on a virtualized environment in vCenter, then you already have that information in the vCenter. Or if you can have a database created which talks about these are the social networking apps, normally the social networking apps specifically are that groups are created by the firewall vendors in the also. The productivity apps and other, basically application-based grouping needs to be done, and this needs to be a dynamic database. That is, once you create a group and map it to a database, the entry in the database is done by the server administrator or some other IT person, but the rule that is implemented, that the security rule that is implemented, that will be based on the high-level policy. Similarly for the conditions, and feeds are important because you might have a command and control feed which might come from, let's say you have a sandboxing solution in your premise that can give you these are the potential command and control rules, malware-based rules, IP. What are the infected IPs? Once a couple of device security devices figure out that this is the IP which is probably infected, maybe your antivirus server gave you that alert. When you create a rule based on infected IP, the IP inside that will keep changing, but the rule should not change. So that's the intent. The high level rule will remain same. The parameters under the rule will keep changing. If you look at the second example over here, you will figure out exactly the same thing. Here there is an additional action like email needs to be sent apart from blocking. So business-based rules, very high-level natural language rules are created, and once the rules are created, the underlying policy will keep changing based on the threat feeds and the database information that you receive from RADIUS and asset management database. But the overall rule will not change. That makes it much easier to manage. With these three building blocks into place, let's look at the let's teach the solution and see how the whole thing looks like. The SDSN is Juniper's terminology called as Software Defined Secure Networks. That is lots of automation involved. If you're seeing this slide now, there are three components in the whole this policy orchestration piece. One is the central part, which is the most important, which is where the policies, natural language based policies, are created. Also, it is the place this is the software which ties in the other piece. On the second left hand side, you will see that the threat detection piece, wherein various methods of threat detection, identification, everything is done, and that feed is given to the policy enforcer. And the right hand side, normally when alert is generated like this, you block it in the firewall, but that's a problem because firewall is there only at the gate. You need someone inside the network also to stop the, let's say one desktop is infected. You can block that in desktop from going accessing traffic on the outside, but meanwhile it will continue to infect the traffic inside the network across the VLAN or maybe inside the same VLAN. So you need to have a policy enforcement which can be done at the switch port level or the wireless LAN access point level. Let's go into each of these three separately. The first one, as I said, is the policy orchestrator. This is a software piece. Lots of pieces are shown over here, but those are software modules inside. You don't need to worry about that. You will get a simple dashboard on which you create a single policy. That single policy can be applied on a firewall or can be applied on a networking system that this software will figure out. If the if a particular policy needs to be applied on a switch, then it will know that only layer 2, layer 3 information can be used. But if it is to be applied in a firewall, it knows that layer 2 information might not be applicable over there because the MAC address might not reach there. So in that scenario, you will have a L4, L7 signature-based rules over here. So you create a single policy, and when the device applies it to the firewall or a switch or a router, it will figure out that how to compile that policy for that particular platform. So the three platforms shown down over here are the firewall, the switches, and stuff like that. Also, this is, as we discussed in the policy creation part, this is a purely intent driven. That is, you don't need to go into specifics of IP address and stuff like that. Give a high level policy intent over there. If you look at the threat detection piece, which was the left hand side piece, here the idea being the firewall or the IPS that is there on the gateway level, it can do only so much calculations because there is a limited CPU, and that's the reason you have a cloud-based intelligence. We call it Sky ATP. ATP is Advanced Threat Protection, where we have machine learning language. It can do dynamic analysis, do a sandboxing and stuff like that. Also, it can take third-party feeds or feeds that is created by your own environment. In fact, lots of people in the finance area, they subscribe to a feeds which is very specific to the financial business. So that security feeds are given by specialist companies which can be merged over here. So you get various feeds like UIP, infected host, CNC, and all those things are compiled by this guy. So that's the important part, so that we can have a normalization of the threat. Also, as I said, the static analysis and dynamic analysis. Static analysis is very simple. Do some machine learning techniques to figure out, let's say, very rough example, if a Word file has got so many words versus so many macros, you figure out at particular percentage, if the macros are more, obviously it's not good, there is something wrong in the file, so potentially it is a much more threatening file, something like that. So all these feeds are compiled, and based on the local intelligence, it will curate the feed and give you a single unified threat level that you can pass it on back to the policy engine, which can take decisions on it. In the policy engine, again, once the threat is compiled, you can have two types of rules. One is global rules, which are applicable to all locations, and you can have site-specific or user-specific rules. And the enforcement is instant. That normally what happens is when you make a change, a rule in the firewall, after that you need to basically commit it, and basically every time you need to do a commit, so there's a small disconnect that happens. In the feed-based or the intent-based SDSN model, remember the top level rule remains same. Even in the firewall, the rule is based on macros. Inside that, the IP address list keep changing, which is enforced by the policy engine. Other thing, as we talked about in a couple of previous slides, is these rules which are created are automatically enforced across a network or a firewall that you have already defined. And if there is a third-party integration, if you have a patch management server, so it can be quarantined using those existing patch management servers. That can be one of the actions it can be doing. Just wanted to show you a screenshot of how the policy engine looks like. If you see the policy engine on the left-hand side, there is a threat management dashboard that is feeds from various sources are coming in, and it is normalizing it to show what are the three feeds, what are the threat levels that is able to curate up. One of the feeds that it is getting that you see on the bottom part is the infected host feed. This is normally created by the antivirus server or maybe the IPS engine, which figured out that a particular of desktops are sending traffic to the command and control network. So based on that, it figured out this host is infected, or maybe the antivirus engine figured out there is a malware running, and so that list is created, and this the policy, if it is created based on infected hosts do so and so thing, the IP address under that will keep on changing based on the real-time information that is received from various sources. And if you see the main dashboard on the right-hand side, there is no firewall. This is not just the firewall that it is managing. It manages the whole network. So it's called a secure fabric in our terminology. So you will have the switches, the access point, the firewall, all put together under a single management control from the security perspective. And then you create an enforcement group saying, let's say a location in Bangalore will have one enforcement group. Locations in outside country, maybe your US location or maybe in different city, they might have a different enforcement group, so that you can make decisions based on the enforcement location based enforcements. The whole thing, as we discussed, is the profiles are created in this location, and the enforcement automatically, it is a closed loop circuit. It gets signal from the left hand side, and then basically it compiles it to actually instruction based on the end device. If it is a high-end firewall versus a normal switch, it will adopt the policy and then send across the actionables over there. In the whole discussion, I only talked about the SDSN, so let's look at the couple of things. This is a single slide on the Juniper security product that is available and which are part of this ecosystem. There are huge amount of firewall, right from a couple of 100 Mbps of throughput to the high-end firewall SRX 5000, 54, 56, 5800, which can go up to 2 Tbps, which are normally deployed in high-end data centers. And also in the service provider backbone for doing the mobile traffic inspection and netting. Apart from that, we have virtual SRX, which is you can take any Intel base or server and run it as a VM that can give you each up to 25 Gbps of next generation firewall throughput, which is quite capable. Also, if you have next generation cloud-based deployments and applications that you're planning based on Docker, and between multiple instances of Docker, which comes and goes very fast, you want to do a stateful inspection with a very low overhead of about couple of percentage, you can do that. And obviously the Sky ATP is an optional service that you can subscribe to if you want to do high level meta analysis and machine learning stuff. Otherwise, the firewalls themselves are capable on their own, but people are increasingly adding the Sky based machine learning techniques over there to curate the feeds and get a much more specific actionable items over there. Let's take a use case now, because we have defined the, in the previous slide, I defined the whole SDSN policy enforcer and the components from the firewall perspective. Let's take a look at how the workflow happens over here. On the left hand side, you can see the core switches, access switches, lots of devices, the firewall and the internet. And in between, you see the couple of components which are required in the back end, normally Sky ATP for curating the feeds and digesting the third party feeds. All those things are given to the SDSN policy engine. This is one of the application which can sit in any of the VMs in your data center. Let's start. Let's say firewall sends an alert that its IPS engine or next generation firewall engine has thought of that this is a particular host which is infected. That information is passed to the Sky ATP. Sky ATP will run a double analysis on that, and it will create policies saying, okay, if it is a firewall policy, then it will contact the firewall manager, which is security director in Juniper's case, which is again a small software module. It's not actually a separate box. It will pass on the instruction to security director, which will do the relevant policy configuration on the firewalls. In the meantime, it will also pass on the instruction to the network director. Again, this is a software module, not a separate device or something, which directly controls the switches. So it will configure the appropriate ACL on this. Now, let's say the what happens is this user is disconnected from the network. The switch ports gets disconnected. Now he's smart. He wants to try it to his neighbor. He takes out his laptop and try to connect it to the neighboring port. In that case, this will still not work, because the firewall has identified the MAC address also. So it even if it keeps moving from port to port, it can identify that there's a MAC address which is moving and do the enforcement at the switch level itself. It will not even allow the traffic to enter the local VLAN and stuff like that. Also, once the switch has been quarantined, there's an optional item. If you have any quarantine software, or if you have any the endpoint remediation software or solution that you have put in place, we can work with them and give you a restricted access so that it can do a policy update, antivirus signature update, and get cure himself and try to authenticate and get back in the network. This is for the campus requirements, and obviously there is a bigger use case that we can have for the data center also. In data center, there are a couple of I have taken a bit complicated segment where lots of virtualized environments are created, and you have decided to install SDN as part of the solution. In this case, I've put a Juniper SDN, which is Contrail, or you can have VMware's SDN. Doesn't matter. So to start with, all the assets that is there in the data center and is virtualized, that asset database is available with the SDN controller. So SDN controller will pass on that information to the SDSN policy engine. So SDSN policy engine has ready access to all the assets. So whenever you say all the databases cannot be accessed by XYZ, so what does database translate to that information from the IP perspective, where that IP sitting in a particular VM, in a particular hypervisor, all that information is already available with the SDSN engine. Also, if you want to do a macro segmentation, that is, if the VMs want to talk to each other, you need to pass it through a stateful firewall engine using our, let's say, virtual SRX, which is a VM version that can run in the infrastructure. Then the deployment of virtual SRX is also done by the Contrail or any SDN controller. Even the VMware NSX controller can deploy those virtual SRXs in all the hypervisors across. With this closed loop instruction, again, everything kicks in. Whatever we saw in the previous scenario, all the policy, all the feeds that is given to the SDSN policy engine, it will digest it and give you an actionable item, which can be a virtual firewall management, or it can be a switch ACL, and it similarly works for the physical firewall as well as the virtual firewall. So it's pretty closed loop. you get a good control of the whole ecosystem over here. So in this example, if the database or IT database wants to talk to financial database, that is blocked. So even though they are in the same zone, database zone, but even then they are blocked. So in a DMZ VLAN, let's say you have an IT app and a fin app, they should not be talking to each other even though they are in the same VLAN. So still it will be blocked. So it's not a VLAN level enforcement, because the enforcement is now done inside the hypervisor. So the assets inside the same VLAN or DMZ zone can still also be controlled, and we can take action on them. last slide, to summarize the whole thing. So what is Juniper SDSN? There are three things that you should take away from this. One is, it's an intent-based policy definition. You do a very high-level policy, the IP address, VLAN, application signature, app ID, all those things are taken care of by the engine. So that's the whole idea of SDSN, a very high-level intent-based policy. The second is pervasive security. That is, we expect you to not deploy this as a parameter security option. You should do it as pervasive security. That is, enforcement should happen not just at the firewalls but at the router level, switch level, and the information that should be fed into this engine should be from all the security devices. Wherever thread feeds are available, that thread feed should be able to be fed to this. And it's a unified framework for policy management. That is, a single place of policy management for across all switches, routers, firewalls. That's the intent. On day one, it will be a Juniper-centric ecosystem, but definitely the framework already says that we want to start supporting the third-party switches and routers as we go along on this. That's all I had. So the summary is, with Juniper SDSN, you can automate the delivery of security. Maybe I will ask Vinay and the audience to start. I'm ready for Q&A, as simple as that. Yeah. The question is SDN pre-installed over here? So yeah. One thing is, SDN is a separate. Yeah. So SDN is a separate software. If the question is specific to SDSN, SDSN is a separate entity. You can buy the firewall or security solutions from Juniper without the SDSN and do the traditional way. Additionally, you can add the SDSN whenever you think you want to do this high-level policy orchestration. So SDSN policy engine is available as a separate product today. It will not be part of the firewalls and stuff.
Asking, can I connect a Juniper router to other vendor routers also?
Yes, that is the plan. That is, the switches on day one, when the policy engine rolls out, it will support only Juniper switches and routers. We would give you an option to do customization. That is, if you want to put a specific command to third-party switches, that will be option available on day one to you, but you will have to do manually. The intent is, we will try to formally support a third-party as we go along. So that, definitely that's the intent, but it will come out in phases.
Hello, Rakesh? There is one more question. How robust is the SDSN platform?
Yeah. The good thing is, since it's out of band kind of control, so let's say for whatever reason, just for the theoretical sake, the SDSN controller goes down, then also rest of the security system will work as it works today. That being said, it's a VM, so you can have two versions of it. And as you say, it's actually not in path, it is out of path. That is, it is getting a feed, and based on that, it is generating an actionable items which are enforced on the switches and firewall. So let's say for some reason this goes out of your network, the rest of the security will continue to work as it works today. So yes, it is stable, but the architecture itself is out of band. That means the whole infrastructure will be pretty much risk-free from any problems that can arise out of SDSN.
One person is asking, how does SDN get visibility of stuff moving in the same VLAN?
Yes. That's an important part. So normally all the if you do an SDN, the networking stack of the hypervisor is replaced by an SDN agent. If you have Juniper SDN, then that component is called vRouter. This vRouter sits or basically takes control of the NIC card of the physical server. So any VMs, when it wants to talk to each other, this guy has taken control. Similarly, if you have VMware deployment, there is something called as VDS, Virtual Distributed Switch, or something equivalent. I think it's called Open Virtual Switch. That sits and takes control of the TCP/IP stack of that hypervisor. So any VM, when they want to talk to each other, everything has to pass through this guy. So there are two things. You can run in a pure policy implementation mode where you say allow or block and that's it. And the other option is it can actually do a sampling of the traffic which is passing through it and send it back to the any IDS, IPS or whatever you have available so that it can get a signal of, just like you do a normal port mirroring between the VMs, also this particular agent can do a pretty much like a port mirroring either at a full throttle or at a particular sampling rate so that that movement visibility is also made available. Or simply put, you can do a flow, it can do a flow export. So if you have flow consumption engine, it will consume that data and pass on the, whatever is the result that particular anomaly is happening, that can be fed back to the SDSN. So it's like a normal networking but in a virtual world.
Okay, so is there anything to do with UTM SDSN?
Yeah, so UTM and firewall, they will continue to play the role. So it is not replacing UTM or firewall. Remember, the job of this was to take the alerts and the signature threat levels which is detected by the firewall UTM IPS engine, take it and basically the way the idea being it is not replacing any of the products that you have in the network, but what it does is today you go to each of these products and do the configuration manually, and you need to have a engine or some dashboard wherein all these alerts you have to manually understand and try to do something about it. With SDSN, first of all, when these products are deployed, you don't do direct configuration of the firewall in Juniper's case, let's say. You do this policy definition in the SDSN. That is, you do a very high-level policy in the SDSN engine. It will figure out that translates to what IP address and what VLAN and stuff, and it will go and configure your multiple firewalls and IPS and UTM devices with the actual IP level policies. So whenever there is change in the asset or change in the user, let's say employee has joined or left or something like that, or a new server has come up or gone down, you don't need to go to any of these UTM devices or firewall to make those changes. The SDSN will pick up that information from the IT database or from the SDN. If you have a virtual server vCenter environment, it will take the database of all the applications from that environment and basically dynamically keep changing the rules. So it will not replace any of those existing devices. What it does, it basically makes sure that the policy orchestration becomes easier, and also it will do an enforcement across based on the attacks. It will do enforcement on firewall, router, switches. So it doesn't replace any of those things, but it basically ties up all those together so that they work like a single homogeneous entity instead of acting on their own alone.
Will SDSN add any delay? It's
Yeah. So asking. Yeah, so the question is, will SDSN add any delay? Important thing is this is not in path, so it will itself not introduce any latency. So if there is a firewall alert, normally if you have configured a gateway firewall, let's say IPS rule saying if something happens like this, do a rate limiting or something like that, it will not change, it will not add additional latency just by introduction of SDSN, because SDSN will configure the firewall policies based on the actions, based on the alerts, but it will itself not do the implementation. So it will not introduce an extra extra delay, because normally what used to happen is all these alerts used to go in the SIEM. SIEM used to wait for you guys to understand and do some action based on it. It will just correlate the event and show it to you. Here, it will close the loop from the action perspective. So real-time traffic, there is absolutely no delay. From the loopback perspective, that is closing the loop from the security perspective, it actually makes the things faster because the actionable items are predefined by the business intent engine and it will just enforce it.
Yeah, Rakesh, there is one more question. There is any kind of agent gets installed in each of the machine and as a result while implementing, after implementing SDHN?
There is no agent that needs to be installed on the Juniper device. Yes, that is all the Juniper firewall router switches, they don't need to have any agent installed at all. For the virtual infrastructure, as you said, you might need to have just like VMware vCenter or something, that kind of software might be required with the SDSN. There the agent will sit in the hypervisor, that is again not a Juniper agent, but the whichever SDN, either Juniper or VMware agent that goes in the firewall, in the hypervisor for SDN perspective, but again it is not SDSN agent. SDSN will directly talk using the normal, and if you see the policy enforcement that was happening, SDSN was not directly talking to the firewall. It was talking to the firewall manager, which was security director. Also, it was not directly configuring the switch. It was going to the network director and saying, make this change to this switch. So, so that no new connectors are required, because all your existing firewall manager, switch manager, network manager, they already have whatever the mechanisms put in place. So, using RESTful API, I will just pass on the instruction to make the configuration changes on the firewall router and switches, but I will not directly make the changes. I will use the existing NMS or firewall managers that you have to do those changes. So no additional, so if it is already deployed, no need to worry about it. We can work with that itself.
So SDSN will be, one more question. SDSN will be integrated in the SDN ecosystem architecture. So, in a modern network orchestration?
Yeah, the answer is yes and no. If you are doing data center based deployment, then obviously SDN has to be there, otherwise you cannot create a micro segmentation or micro parameterization, because somebody needs to have access inside the VM to do the policy enforcement. So yes, in the data center environment, SDN would be required, because that's the only way I can do micro segmentation. But in the campus world and basically big wide multi-campus deployment, there is no SDN required. There I will use the your switch manager, firewall manager, security manager to do the job. So yes, in data center, if you don't use SDN, then I will not have small visibility between the VMs. That might not be good from most deployment perspective, but in campus and traditional data centers where there is not much virtualization, there you don't need any SDN.